It's an absolute pleasure to have you here tonight. I guess the first question, for anyone who hasn't had the joy of seeing this film, can you give us a quick synopsis of Any Day Now and maybe talk a little bit about the real life inspiration behind it?
Oh, well, it's based on this real person who I play, who was a drag queen in New York in the 70s, who kind of took in a little boy who was very severely mentally and physically disabled, and kind of like, you know, was a parent to him because his mother kind of was a bit of a crackhead. And so that's what it's based on. And in the film, I play that character, and Garrett Dillahunt plays a man who I become involved with. And at the same time, I find the little boy. He's got Down syndrome in our story. And so we become this sort of unexpected family. And it goes really well. We're really a great family. The little boy blossoms. We are in love and everything's great. And then, you know, prejudice and bigotry and hatred kind of looms and he gets taken away from us. And it's about our struggle to get him back.
And I think despite the fact that the film is a period piece, it feels so timely and so relevant now. I mean, is that one of the things that attracted you to it, that the way the film speaks to current world events?
Absolutely. I think in a funny sort of way, because it's a period piece, you can sort of stand back from it and look at it. But in so doing, you realise that that not much has changed. There's been great strides in some areas, but bigotry and prejudice and homophobia have not ebbed. I've not disappeared. So it's really, I think that was actually one of the main reasons why I did want to do it, because I thought it did have a lot to say about, it's good to remember that great things have happened, but we mustn't be complacent, and we mustn't, like, you know, be grateful for getting our rights. We should, they are rights, not privileges, and we should demand them.
Despite the fact the film addresses these horrible evils, at the heart of it, it's a story of love, and I think Isaac is such an important part of telling that story. Can you talk about working with this very special young man?
He's absolutely an absolute darling. I mean, he's like this light. And I'm just, you know, one of the best things about doing this film is meeting him and spending that time with him. And you know, since the film's been at all these film festivals and stuff, when it came out in America, getting to see him at all these other events, and keeping in touch with him. We sent a little photo to him tonight. He's just this lovely, you know, all his emotions are on the surface. When he's happy, he jumps up and down with joy. When he's sad, he just weeps inconsolably. He's a big crier. When the film opened in New York, the premiere, he went up on stage and he started weeping because he was so happy. And all the audience were like, oh, we were all like, oh, Isaac, come on. So he's just a darling boy, and he kind of reminded me what acting should be like. It should be just, boom, you know, that's, you're right there. And then your emotion's right there, and you just get on with it.
I guess fans are going to want to know, what have you got coming up next? Where are we going to see you? I mean, there's been a lot of talk over the last year or two if we'd ever see you in the X-Men franchise again. How do you feel about that? I mean, I believe we're not seeing you in Days of Future Past. Is that correct?
It's correct. I'm not in that. They haven't actually ever... I was nearly going to be... I was supposed to be in the third one. I was under contract, and then that didn't happen. And then they sort of did a little kind of slight chat about this one, but I think I don't know. I wasn't, and I don't know. I would. It's one of these things. Everyone's kind of a little obsessed by it, except me.
Such a good character.
It was a great character, but you know, it's a long time ago now, and I've kind of moved on. But if they ask me again, I would definitely consider it. But right now, that's not going to happen. But actually, the week after this film comes out, this comes out September the 6th, and then September the 13th. And this film called Sir Billy the Vet, a Scottish animated film that I did with Sean Connery. He plays Billy the Vet, and I play his goat, Gordon. So that comes out, and then I go back tomorrow to New York because I'm in the middle of filming The Good Wife, the fifth season of The Good Wife, so I'm doing that.
What was it about this particular story that made you so determined to be a part of bringing it to the big screen?
Well, when I first read the script was originally written in 1979. First and foremost, it was just a beautifully written piece of drama. The characters I immediately responded to, Rudy and the young boy. The Paul character was not in the first draft. It was something that I added. And so I saw it as an opportunity and a challenge to update a script to tell a 70s period piece, and also I've experienced, as I think everybody has, I've experienced a certain amount of loss in my life. And so that sense of loss and that sense of injustice, I had experienced a bit of in my life and wanted to speak about some personal things while telling a dramatic story.
And of course, there's a very tender chemistry, I think, between Alan and Garrett's characters. Can you talk a little bit about the importance of casting them and that particular dynamic?
Well, the two of them do such a beautiful job. Alan and Garrett are able to step in really without rehearsal and immediately start to form a bond and a chemistry. And like really, really good actors, you know, there's no hesitation. Whether you're doing a love scene, whether you're doing a funny scene, I mean, they just leapt right in. They put a lot of faith in me as a director. I mean, we had a small production, you know, relatively limited budget, and so they put a lot of faith in me, and I think both of their performances are, you know, as a person who sat in the editing room watching hours and hours and hours of footage over and over, there's almost not a dishonest moment in their entire performance that we had to sort of whittle out in editing. They're just beautiful, honest performances.
Of course, this family wouldn't have been complete without an astonishing performance by young Isaac. Can you talk a bit about discovering him and what he's brought to the film?
Well, we put out a nationwide search around the U.S. for a boy and got a number of tapes emailed to me. And I looked at 30, 40, 50, and when I finally saw Isaac's, there was something so honest and smart about his performance. And then he smiled that beautiful big smile of his at the end of his first audition. And I knew, you know, I sort of knew he was the right kid. And I will tell you, he brought, as great actors do, there are scenes in the script that changed on set because of his performance. And that's what I think sometimes what great actors do. They bring an element of themselves. They bring a perspective. And there's a wonderful scene where he goes to his bedroom for the first time and kind of breaks down. And that was, Isaac got emotional. And that allowed me as a director to change the scene on set. So he was wonderful to work with.
Of course, I think the music in the film is a very poignant communicator of those emotions, particularly the final song that lends the film its title. Can you talk a little bit about that selection and that aspect of the film?
Well, my music supervisor, PJ Bloom, I think is a real master at finding music and finding, both of us try very hard to point at the emotion, to point at what we're, without maybe going too directly at it. When he brought up the I Shall Be Released song, I said, you know, holy hell, if we can get the Dylan song, that would be just a beautiful way to end the film. And thankfully, he was able, through his connections and through his sort of stature as a music supervisor, he was able to reach out directly to Bob Dylan's manager and secure the song. And Alan does such a beautiful job, particularly when you think about, you know, he's got to, in a sense, do a performance in a recording studio 2 weeks before he actually does it on stage and then replicate it. He does a beautiful job with it.
I guess, I mean, my final question. The film's obviously a period piece, but it feels so topical right now. Was it difficult for you to avoid the label of being seen as an agenda film or a film that has a particular goal and to maintain that sense that it's just, at its heart, a love story, a story about family?
Sure. Well, I tried very, very hard in the writing of the film, on set, and then in particular in the editing of the film, to not push the agenda, to not push the politics of it. I knew that would be there by its inherent nature. It's a story about two men fighting a legal system to adopt a child. So that's there. Tried instead to really focus on the love story. Tried to focus on Alan and Garrett's relationship, their relationship with the boy, and tell that story. And I knew if we had done our job there, hopefully the sort of the political agenda would speak through and touch audiences and resonate with audiences.